When the stars come out in D.C., they always shine brightest right here on Washington Full Circle. And today, our celebrity spotlight is on one of the hottest young stage actors around, Latino heartthrob Nicholas Rodriguez. I'm Valikia Newsom, and Washington Full Circle starts right now. Versatile performers around these days is a young Latin American actor that's been lighting up the stage from Broadway to D.C. His name is Nicholas Rodriguez, and he's played everyone from Jesus and Jesus Christ Superstar to Tarzan. He even made history on daytime soaps with the first same-sex marriage storyline. Washington Full Circle's Ferman Patterson had the chance to catch up with this very talented and very busy young actor. Take a look at our Celebrities in the City interview with actor-singer Nicholas Rodriguez.
So, Nicholas Rodriguez, you actor, singer, entertainer, and one of Washington's favorite actors. You're from New York, but you're spending a lot of time here. You've conquered the Washington scene.
Thank you. That's very generous of you. I don't know about conquered, but I'm having a good time, that's for sure.
Now, you've done a lot of things with the arena stage. Tell us about some of the other things you've done in the stage with arena.
The first time I was here, I did a play called Light in the Piazza. I played a young Italian boy in Florence. And then I was here in 2010 doing Oklahoma. I did My Fair Lady here. And then Arena recently produced a concert that I developed with Alicia Gamble called The Power of Two that we ran at the Arena stage. So.
People always have one moment in their lifetime where it's, they realize, this is what I want to do. When did you first become interested in acting, say, oh, I want to be an actor?
Yeah, I remember it very vividly. My mother took me to see the national tour of Ain't Misbehavin' in Austin, Texas. I believe it was about 1989. And we just happened to be sitting around the front row. And I didn't realize that those people up there were doing that was their job, and that they got to like sing and dance and make a living doing it. So it was like no turning back after that, you know?
Scarce to be counted. Filling the darkness with order and light.
You're no stranger to awards. You won a Helen Hayes Award.
I did.
Tell us about that.
You know, it was kind of the cherry on top. Doing Oklahoma here in Washington, D.C. was just such a gift, you know, not only because it was an amazing show, but it was a multiracial cast, which is just a beautiful thing to be a part of. And it opened the Mead Center for the American Theater, which was another amazing thing. So then to get the award and to get the recognition is just, was just kind of a dream come true.
I'm Mother Curry. Everybody knows me.
Just wait, you'll bend. In time, you'll find the vows you make are the vows you'll break.
The incomparable Kathleen Turner.
Yeah.
Was this the first time you worked with her?
It's the first time we worked together. Oh, officially, last year exactly, we did the March for Washington on Gun Control, where I sang and Kathleen spoke. So that was the first time that we got to really interact together. So this is our first time starring in a play together. So it's exciting and a little intimidating, I'm not gonna lie. But she's amazing to work with.
My Fair Lady.
Oh, romantic. Classic. It was a beautiful production, sumptuous clothing, all-time classic score.
Tarzan.
You have to do a lot of sit-ups when you're doing Tarzan because you're half naked. But it was a fun Phil Collins pop rock score, you know, and such a huge challenge. I loved it.
Of course, Jesus Christ Superstar.
Iconic, classic, huge challenge, big vocal sing, and a lot of fun.
Evita.
Oh, man. You know, I played Che Guevara. When you're doing Evita, you have to think of it as your show, you know, so the title should be Che, because it's like a, you know, a 3-hour tour de force, and it's like one man against the entire ensemble. It's awesome.
A lot of Washingtonians will know you from your role in One Life to Live on ABC, and you played a very interesting character that I understand was only supposed to be on a few episodes, but something happened.
Something happened. I was originally only scheduled to do 3.5 episodes, and then halfway through the filming of my second episode, the producers were liking what was happening and decided to continue writing that story arc, which led us into sweeps, which led us into another 3 months. So it just kind of snowballed, and my character just continued to get developed.
Apparently you got fan mail, you got people saying, oh, you know, I'm glad you did that, or I sort of saw myself in that character. Tell us about that.
Well, I played I was the first same-sex couple to get married on daytime television, right. and so there was a lot of firsts. It was a gay wedding and a gay kiss and the whole down money proposal. So it just made people think, and I was so proud to be a part of that.
Stay with us. Washington Full Circle returns right after this with more of our Celebrities in the City interview with actor Nicholas Rodriguez.
Welcome to Bergdorf Goodman. May I help you?
Yes, our friend is getting married.
You did something that was actually based on a TV show, a very popular TV show, Sex in the City.
Uh-huh.
You did one of the movies, Sex in the City 2. Tell us about that experience and tell us about that change from doing one thing to that.
It was a fun time. I got cast in it, the casting director, Bernie Telsey, not only was I doing One Life to Live, but I was doing at night, I was doing The Toxic Avenger off Broadway, and he happened to be there and saw it with his son, and he just pointed at me. I saw him on the third row. The next day I get a call from my agent saying, Bernie wants you to come in and meet with Michael Patrick King for the Sex and the City movie, and we did, and it was fun.
What's the name?
Oh, Blatch, it's Stanford Blatch.
Actually, I think they're registered under both names. Her best gay friend is marrying my best gay friend.
That's wonderful.
I know.
So tell me about the Broadway Dream Foundation.
The Broadway Dreams Foundation is very near and dear to my heart. I'm the artistic director for the past 2 seasons. Basically what we do is we take Broadway directors, actors, choreographers, casting directors, and then we go to communities around the country and we provide master classes and training in the arts. Not just musical theater, but film, on-camera acting. And we provide this training for students regardless of their ability to pay. And some of our students have gone on to star in their own Broadway shows, national tours. It's such an amazing, rewarding, fulfilling passion of mine.
You seem to be one of those conscientious entertainers that also wants to do something for the community.
Yep, Smile, yep.
Yes, yes.
Supporting and mentoring youth advocates and leaders, yep. It's an amazing organization here in Washington, D.C. I started working with them maybe 3 years ago. It's near and dear to my heart, and it supports the LGBTQ community, especially youth, and mentoring them, and provides not only advocacy classes and leadership training for them, I mean, it helps find job placement, but it also provides things like HIV screening, counseling, amazing after-school programs for some of these children that are dealing with coming out issues that might not have such a supportive home structure. Mm-hmm. And it's just such an amazing, amazing organization. I can't say enough about it.
So switching over to something a little lighter, mm-hmm. Your hobbies. I understand you like cooking shows. Top Chef and those
I love
days.
It. I love Top Chef. Yeah, total guilty pleasure.
Can you cook?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, it's a new.
Really?
I mean, I think so. I don't get many complaints, but I've definitely gotten better because of Top Chef. So, yeah. I recently bought a house maybe 4 years ago, and I think before then I could make like one or two dishes, but now one of my favorite pastimes is just getting in the kitchen and like throwing things together and trying it, and it's amazing. Just, you know, I love it. I have an affinity for it. I don't know that I'd ever want to do it as a job, right. You know, but yeah. I love doing it for my friends and family. Yeah.
Washington is a restaurant city.
Sure. I mean, Oyamel is always one of my favorites. Jose Andres, mm-hmm. amazing. Sticking on the Mexican theme, my favorite guilty pleasure on a Sunday night after the show is L'Oreal Plaza. Get the big thing of fajitas and a margarita. It's definitely, you'll catch me there. I go to Old Ebbets a lot. You know, and also for actors, they're open later. So they're like, where can we still go and eat after the show comes down?
Excellent, excellent. Yeah. Those are some of my favorites also.
Oh, really?
Thanks so much. Yeah, I appreciate you talking with you.
Absolutely.
I hope you see in a lot more plays here in D.C.
Absolutely.
And on the big screen, too.
Thank you.
And on the small screen.
Yeah, let's do it. Do it all.
Washington Full Circle will be right back after this.
Original dream girl. At 21 years old, Jennifer Holliday riveted Broadway audiences with her show-stopping, heart-wrenching performance of And I'm Telling You, I Am Not Going. It earned her both a Tony Award and a Grammy for her recording of the song. And it's been an iconic song covered around the world ever since. But after several hits in the 90s, she has not released a CD for over 20 years. Today, Jennifer Holliday is back with a new album, back with that incredible voice, and back to tell some stories. Thank you so much for joining us. It's
Thank
a pleasure
you.
To have you here.
I'm very happy to be here with you.
Now, you have a new CD, and is it a new sound for you?
Well, it's not so much a new sound. My voice is still the same, but I just wanted to maybe show that people that I've grown some musically. So it's cover tunes of some jazz love songs and some R&B tunes as well.
And one of them is At Last, the Etta James classic?
Yes, I dedicated each song to a female that I admire. And I think that a lot of people don't think that singers actually still admire other singers, even when they become whatever they are to people, you know. So I still listen to so many great recordings. And so I dedicated each song to someone I admired.
And who are some of the people you admire?
Nancy Wilson, Aretha Franklin, of course. Aretha Franklin, of course, my all-time idol. Gladys Knight, Patti LaBelle. So just people that, you know, you take little bitty things from, you know, not that you want to sound like them, but some things you go, oh, okay, I love the way she does that. Wonder can I incorporate some of that in my style?
Right. Mm-hmm. And of course, At Last is the Etta James classic.
Oh, yes.
And it gained some new notoriety or I guess some new pizzazz with the Beyonce recording.
Yes.
And now you're giving it your special spin.
Yes, and so mine's a little bit more R&B, meaning that I have, not that I have more soul than Beyonce, but sometimes, you know, I think that I can just lift it to a little bit different place from my voice, not only from my voice, but because of just age and sometimes when you live a long time, you can add something to a song that no one else can add just because of your experiences. So I do think that I have Etta James' blessing to do this. I did get a chance to meet her and spend some time with her. So I do think that she would be pleased and I hope proud.
Now, also, this album was the first in a very long time. Music has changed a lot since your earlier hits. Mm-hmm. What led to your thinking, oh, I might do some standards, I might do some other things? You looked over the music scene and thought what?
Well, I thought that there's not much in the new music scene. That's what I thought. That's what I was like, ooh, okay. It's not much, in terms of new great songs that you wish that you could sing. And so, like I said, just coming back, how do you want to come back different? Do you want to just come back and try to copy or try to be something? So since I had been away for a long time and didn't really know a lot of new songwriters and producers, and I did this myself and it's on my own label, I said, well, why don't I start with cover tunes? Now, if some people want to write for me, like John Legend, I'm not trying to make a hint or anything like that, but if John Legend get a feeling that he want to write a song for Jennifer Holliday, she gonna sing it. Okay? She gonna sing it, but she didn't know John Legend, and she still don't know him, so I just went into what I know best, which is to do some great songs and put a Jenniferized kind of touch on them.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, we have to go back to that iconic song,
sure.
And I'm telling you, I'm not going. You reacted to the reintroduction of the song through the movie
yes.
with the other Jennifer.
Right.
We won't say who that other Jennifer
right,
is.
Right.
But hearing that song, what did it make you think when it first debuted in the film?
Well, I think, you know, a lot of mixed emotions, and those who followed the story, you know, that there was quite a bit of drama going on, you know, with that. But once all of that settled, I couldn't help but be proud, because to have done something that would go into a new generation mm-hmm. and have a new life, you know, just made me feel very, very proud. So, you know, I always tell people, I say I have a Grammy, I have two Grammys, a Tony and an Oscar. That's because Jennifer sharing her Oscar, she don't know it, but the two Jennifers have two Oscars.
Now tell me, is this true? I think I heard something about you getting your own Oscar. Mm-hmm. That you actually tell us about that.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, in California, you know, they sell them. So you can just go buy you one. All right? So
right.
I just put my own thing on it and just went and got me one. But again, out of pride, not out of, you know, some kind of bitterness or anger or something, all of that so far behind me, that I can definitely celebrate what it has become to so many other people. So I have to take myself, you know, out of the situation.
Certainly.
This song is
right.
way bigger than I am now and what it means to so many people.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's go back to those years after Dreamgirls, yes. the original stage version.
Yes.
And you went through some changes. There was a weight issue
yes.
that you dealt with. But then you're back and you're looking fantastic and far slimmer.
Thank you.
But the question was, I guess, was did that change your music at all? Did you feel any difference in the singing?
Well, I've had the weight off for quite a while, well over 25 years, and so to me, I think that it didn't change my sound, but it changed the way people thought about that it had to do with my sound.
Right.
So a lot of people went, "Oh my God, so is she gonna? Can she still sing? Can she still sing?" And so it was a long time where I could even really get work for a while because I had a new kind of rejection, a rejection as a small lady. And that was strange because for so many years being rejected as a heavy set lady, and then to lose weight and have an identity crisis in terms of people associating mm-hmm. my sound with my weight.
Yeah.
And so that was very hard and long years before I could work. Then I got lucky with Ally McBeal, for those who are old enough to remember that show. And then people got to see me and hear me and say, okay, she still sounds sounds the same,
and she sounds fantastic.
Even though she's smaller, so that helped a lot.
Yeah, and of course you're sounding fantastic. You're looking fantastic.
Thank you.
And everyone's looking forward to seeing more things out of you in the coming years. Thank you so much for being with us today. It's
a
pleasure from a big fan.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And that's it for this edition of Washington Full Circle. I'm Ferman Patterson, and please be sure to join us again next time.